But the question I want to put right squarely in front of you is, where is the church?
I want to take a moment to welcome as our preacher this morning our own Reverend Dr. Roslyn Brock. We are excited about what God is going to do through you this morning as we continue to pray your strength in the Lord. God bless you.
Good morning, Alfred Street.
Morning.
And welcome to a historic moment in the life of this church. For those of you who are seated here this morning, you have the privilege of witnessing the last 11 a.m. service and the hour of power. Oh, great God from Zion. So I hope that you will get your clock straight next Sunday so that you will know and be on time for the service that you'd like to participate in. But very seriously, church, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. And I offer no apologies this morning for my race or for my color. I'm glad that God has given me this opportunity yet again to come into this place. For I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Because there's something about fellowshipping with fellow laborers in Christ. So those of you who know the words of prayer, I ask that you pray my strength in the Lord. To our great pastor, my pastor, the Reverend Dr. Howard John Wesley in his absence, to Reverend Judy Fentress Williams, our worship leader. We ask God that you will continue to watch over that team that shepherds this flock. I'm grateful today that my father in the ministry, Reverend Ed Jackson, is here this morning on the morning's bench, standing in the gap for Daddy John Peterson. I'm so grateful this morning. But church, did you enjoy the musical selection from Maestro Ralph Herndon and our ministry choir? Y'all can do better than that. God has already done what he said he was gonna do. Oh, praises be to God. We miss you, Ralph. We miss that voice. Sounds like James Cleveland. But you got another twist. God has anointed you for such a time as this. Give God some praise for this maestro as he continues to minister in music across the length and breadth of this nation. To the deacons and the clergy of this church, I ask for your prayers. But if you would just stand now as we go to the word, I ask you to turn to the Old Testament book of Joshua, the first chapter, the first through the ninth verse. I will be reading from the New Living Translation. When you find it, say amen.
Amen.
Thus says the word of God. After the death of Moses, the Lord's servant, the Lord spoke to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' assistant, and he said, Moses, my servant is dead. Therefore, the time has come for you to lead these people, the Israelites, across the Jordan River and to the land that I am giving them. I promise you, Joshua, what I promised Moses. Wherever you set your foot, you will be on the land that I gave you. From the Negev wilderness in the south to the Lebanon mountains in the north. From the Euphrates River in the east to the Mediterranean Sea in the west. Including all the land of the Hittites. No one will be able to stand against you as long as you live. For I will be with you as I was with Moses. I will not fail you or abandon you. Be strong and courageous, for you are the one who will lead these people to possess all the land I swore to their ancestors. I will give thee. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the instructions Moses gave you. Do not deviate them, turning either to the right or to the left. Then you will be successful in everything you do. Study this book of instruction continually. Meditate on it day and night, so you will be sure to obey everything written in it. Only then will you prosper and succeed in all you do. This is my command. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. You may take your seats. Let us pray. Lord, that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. For, O Lord, you are surely my strength and my redeemer. Let your people see less of me and more of thee. This is thy servant's prayer. In the name of the one who came to save us all, amen. For a few minutes, church, I want to share with you around the subject, Faithful is Our God. I sat in the sanctuary this morning at the 8 o'clock service, and thank God as I listened to the anointed message given by Dr. Faye Gunn when she preached on the subject, the Lord is good. That was confirmation for me because the past few weeks have been very, very trying, with the sudden passing of NAACP Chairman Emeritus Julian Bond, who was one of my mentors in the civil rights movement. I served for nearly 10 years as his vice chairman and was blessed when he endorsed me to succeed him to become the 14th chairman of the board of the nation's oldest and largest civil rights organization. We've also lost other civil rights leaders recently, namely former Congressman Lewis Stokes, and then on Wednesday, Miss Amelia Boynton Robinson, the 104-year-old civil rights activist in Ava DuVernay's movie entitled Selma. If you don't recall her character, she was the woman with the cat glasses. Remember her? She was the chief architect of the marches that happened on the Edmund Pettus Bridge that brought us the Voting Rights Act of 1965. On last Monday, I joined a multicultural, multi-intergenerational group of citizens from across this nation, And I walked 22 miles in the heat of the day from Leesburg, Batesville, South Carolina, to outside the city limits of Columbia, the capital city, and the NAACP's America's Journey for Justice. This march is a grueling 860-mile trek over 40-some days that began August the 1st at the foot of the Edmund Pettus Bridge in Selma, Alabama, and will end September 16th in the halls of Congress under the banner that our votes, our jobs, our schools, and yes, indeed, our lives matter. The march across South Carolina focused on criminal justice as we remembered the 9 lives lost in Charleston, South Carolina, at Mother Emanuel AME Church, and the lives of Walter Scott, Tamir Rice, Michael Brown, Eric Gardner, Freddie Gray, and Sandra Bland. Deuteronomy, the 16th chapter and the 20th verse says, "Justice, O justice, you shall follow that so that you may live and inherit the land that the Lord your God has given you." I would be remiss this morning if I did not mention the stellar police escort that we receive by black and white law enforcement officers and state troopers on the back roads and city streets on highway number 1. Y'all know that one? Through Alabama, through Georgia, through South Carolina, and now through North Carolina. We of the NAACP were grateful for these men and women who put their lives on the line to protect and to serve us as we march through some dangerous, racist territory in this nation. But as I walked on that journey, I walked alongside a 68-year-old disabled veteran from Colorado named Middle Passage, who had undergone 5 open heart surgeries since the 1980s. I marched alongside a female Jewish rabbi named Alina from the Central Conference of American Rabbis, who carried the Torah, weighing 18 pounds. I marched beside a 66-year-old gentleman named Ivan, who kept us in time by the clicking of his cane on the hot South Carolina pavement. I marched, my friends, in memory of Julian Bond and Lewis Stokes and other fallen civil rights leaders who stood up for justice, who marched and protested for equity in this nation, because the power and depth of their witness has only been magnified by their passing, as it has awakened a deeper sense of the blessing we had when they were in our midst. Lest we forget today those who have brought us over and who have led us through some difficult terrain. This year marks the 60th anniversary of the murder of Emmett Till, the 52nd anniversary of the March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom, the 50th anniversary of the assassination of Malcolm X, Bloody Sunday in Selma, Alabama, and the passage of the Voting Rights Act of 1965, the 50th anniversary of the race riots in California, and the issuance of Executive Order 11246. That instituted affirmative action in contracting for those who look like you and me. And lest we forget our pastor and those clergy and members of our ministries who are traveling with him in New Orleans, Louisiana, this weekend marks the 10th anniversary of Hurricane Katrina. Lest we forget where we've come from, the trials and the tribulations we've gone through, and the people who have made the difference in our lives. Each of these significant milestones in our journey have allowed us to move to the next level and to examine the critical work ahead. In his address at the conclusion of the Selma to Montgomery March, Dr. Martin Luther King recalled the story of Joshua and the Battle of Jericho. And he used this example to endorse nonviolent marches in the civil rights movement. Well, this morning I want to return to that story, but I want to return with a focus on leadership transition from Moses to Joshua. Because we have a lot of Joshuas in this audience. So I encourage you to put these 9 verses in your smart tablets, in your iPads, and in your smartphones, and refer to them often. The first test of transference of leadership is one that you have to heed the call. I believe the Old Testament story of Joshua is one of the best leadership development stories in the Bible, because it reminds us that through the shifting clouds of circumstance and changes in human history, God will raise up men and women so that he could use them as fitting instruments to accomplish his purpose. God used both Moses and Joshua, that intergenerational linkage, and he shared with both of them when he said, "I'll never leave you nor forsake you, because I'm going to be with you until the work is complete." You see, in Joshua chapter 1, Moses had died, and God tells Joshua that you will be the next leader of this people. Joshua was to lead the people and possess the land. This was not a decision that he took lightly. But although he was well past middle age, Joshua accepted God's challenge. He was called to conquer a land, and God is calling each of us this morning as disciples to conquer a nation. Our weapons are different, but we do not fight against flesh and blood. We need the strength and courage, but it's different this time. On this Christian journey, we must never forget that we've got to endure battles before victory. There will be struggles before celebration, steps before arrivals, practice before perfection, preparation before completion, matriculation before graduation, and revelation before liberation. When God calls us, we need to be in a position to heed the call. But once we heed the call, we must listen for his commands. Joshua and Caleb were the only ones of a generation who had seen the Red Sea deliverance. This new Joshua generation had only heard about the great escape from Pharaoh's army. They had not witnessed it and didn't understand the breadth, the depth, and the pain of our struggle. They were not present back then and could not relate to the current situation. Does that sound familiar? We've got a whole generation in this nation of young people who have forgotten from where we've come. But I'm so glad this morning that God has raised up young men and women from Black Lives Matter and from Dream Defenders who are willing to step out and speak out in the public square about the injustices that are happening in our nation. Just like the young Israelites that Joshua led, the young leaders of today may not fully understand the struggle. They didn't have to cross the Edmund Pettus Bridge. They don't know what it feels like to have dogs or fire hose and weapons used against them. But my friends, don't be deceived, because my young brothers and sisters will tell you that they've had their own bridges to cross. They've had their own battles to fight and mountains to climb. They will tell you that they know what it's like to be pulled over driving while black. They understand that even walking down the street at any given time, they can be stopped by police officers, frisked and interrogated, and even handcuffed for simply walking while black. This generation may not know Jim Crow, but they fully understand the power and the magnitude of James Crow Esquire. How he holds their entire future in the palm of his hands as he writes redistricting laws to prevent them from the power they have in the vote. They know that even the precious right to vote that our forefathers fought for and died for is now being challenged all across this land. Just like the generation that Joshua led, our new leaders may not have experienced God the way their forefathers experienced. We knew God as Savior. Our young leaders are looking for a Messiah. But too often they don't understand that sometimes you got to stand still and know that He is God. Too often we're so busy rushing, trying to get to the finish line, that we want to have God's resources, but we don't want to live by His timing. We forget that the work that God is doing in us while we wait on Him and stand our ground. Once we move forward to heed God's call and to hear His command, He asks us and challenges us in that ninth verse to have courage. He says, be strong and courageous, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Three times in the text, God told Joshua to be strong and courageous. I believe God was speaking to the inherent weaknesses in Joshua and in all of us. When He said, be strong and courageous. Maybe Joshua was like many of you who have a desire to do something, but believe that you lack the knowledge, the skill, or the expertise to get the job done. I challenge you this morning to wait patiently in the shadows. You're too afraid to wait patiently in the shadows for someone. You're waiting for someone or something to ignite your fire. How many of you in this sanctuary are facing difficult personal and professional situations? When you're just not sure if you're up to the task, is there anybody in the sanctuary this morning who's got some stuff going on? Let me tell you something, that if you don't acknowledge that you're going through something, I guarantee you, in the next few days, that your hands will be raised towards heaven, because life is a series of challenges and obstacles. You're either coming out of a storm, in the midst of a storm, or you're headed towards a storm. Oh, I wish somebody here in the church understood what it's like to go through a storm and be afraid that you don't know if you're going to make it on the other side. We've had ups and downs throughout this land. We've encountered setups and setbacks. But great God from Zion, as a race of people, we have a testimony this morning that through it all, God has been faithful to us. If we just put our trust in Him, He said, I'll be faithful and I'll see you through to the end. It's time now, my friends, to mobilize and to energize a new generation of Joshuas who will advance a national social justice agenda that speaks truth to power. But the question I want to raise to you this morning, I've given you a social justice analogy, but the question I want to put right squarely in front of you is, where is the church? Where is the church? Several years ago, African-American professor of religion from Princeton University, Eddie Gald, published an article in which he said, the black church is dead. in his assessment, he said that the most important reason that the black church is dead is because it has failed to sustain its historic position as a prophetic and progressive voice in the African American community. In short, he summarized that the black church no longer addresses the economic and social needs of its congregants. Bishop Eddie Dixon from Houston put it this way. He said, "Too many black churches have become cruise ships and not battleships. They're focused more on entertaining members than preparing them and arming them with the biblical tools necessary to fight against the principalities, powers, and rulers of darkness in this world. Too often our houses of worship have strayed away from the biblical narrative found in the fourth chapter of Luke's gospel when it said, 'The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners, recovery of sight for the blind, and to set the captives free.'" How many times have you heard the social justice ministry? Pastor Wesley had sat here on Sunday after Sunday, pulling pages from the narratives across this country, making it plain for us that we have a responsibility not only to get our souls right, but we've got to worry about what's happening outside these walls, because everybody ain't having a good time in life. Some of us have forgotten where we come from. Look where God has brought us. See how far we've come. Not what we ought to be, but we thank God that we're not what we used to be. That is the 21st century imperative of the church. We need the black church to once again be the prophetic voice in the justice movement of this nation. Alfred Street, John Peterson, "My servant is dead, but I've raised up a Joshua in the name of Howard John Wesley to lead you higher and higher. All I ask you to do is put your faith in God and understand that he is faithful to carry you until the end." In this justice movement, we need the church to once again heed the call, to hear the command, and to have courage. The church must be strong and courageous. It needs to lead its people from the regressive policies that strip us of our voting rights. We need the black church to stand up and bring about unity in racially polarized community, acknowledging that we serve a sovereign God who declared, "If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and I'll heal their land." Our social justice vision of liberty, justice, and freedom for all has to be elevated to the high moral ground of faith that's found in the faithfulness of God, and a God who will not fail, a God who will not falter, a God who does not change, and a God who will not disappoint. I'm calling on this generation of Christians, this Joshua generation, to stand up and do something. Because when we look back over our lives down through the years, we can see how faithful God has been to this generation. This generation who sits in boardrooms when our parents could only sit in mail rooms. This generation who sleeps in hotel presidential suites when our parents could only sweep dusty city streets. This generation, this Joshua generation, who drives Bentleys, Porsches, Mercedes, and Jags, when all their parents had was filthy rags. This generation, what are you afraid of? Lift up your heads, O ye saints. It's time, now is the time, for you to get off your bed of sorrow and apathy. Step out of your glass-stained cathedral houses of worship and raise your prophetic voice in the public square. For the same God that brought Moses and Joshua out of Egypt is the same God who will lead us once again to sing that great hymn of the church, "Great is thy faithfulness." Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand has provided. Great is thy faithfulness unto me. God gives us strength this morning, church, not only for today, but he gives us bright hope for tomorrow. And it is with this faith that we should be able to live as one in a nation, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice, not just for some, but with liberty and justice for all. It is with this faith that we should hold up the blood-stained banner of Calvary to declare to a dying world our biblical mandate for liberation and justice as a tenet of our faith. I'm so glad this morning that God has issued a call. And he's asking for us to answer that call, to hear his command. But most important, he wants us to have courage, a charge to keep I have, a God to glorify, a never-dying soul to save and fit it for the sky, to serve this present age, my calling to fulfill. Oh, may it all my power engage to do my master's will. Alfred Street, because of the faithfulness of God, courage must not skip this generation. We're calling on this generation, this Joshua generation, to stand up, rise up, stand firm, move out, and speak truth to power.